BBC.
BBC.
You're with the BBC. Now on the BBC World Service, it's time for Witness. It's 79 years since Adolf Hitler became Chancellor of Germany. Andrew Whitehead has been talking to the historian Eric Hobsbawm about Hitler's rise to power, as he remembers it from his teenage years in Berlin.
It's the 25th of January 1933. The National Socialists are in the ascendant in Germany, but not yet in full control. 15-year-old Eric Hobsbawm has taken to the streets, along with tens of thousands of other left-wingers, to try to forestall Hitler's rise to power on a chill winter evening in the German capital.
Very cold. Berlin, as you know, is one of the coldest cities. The wind blows directly from Siberia, they always say, and it did. I think it was the last legal demonstration of the German Communist Party. Vast quantities of people turned up. Berlin was on the whole a very red city, or at least contained large red quarters. And we were marching, or rather shuffling along in the evening, singing songs, somehow or other, knowing that it wasn't going to do much good.
When you say knowing that it wasn't going to do much good, what was the political mood like in Berlin at that time?
The thing is, we knew that what was on the cards was Hitler coming to power in one way or another, the National Socialists. We knew that if this happened, the chances of communists would be very small. We believed we were going to be the victims and we were going to stand up to persecution. And I think that was behind a lot of the feelings that as we were marching or shuffling, demonstrating not only our strength, but, if you like, our commitments.
You make it sound a bit like a funeral march.
In retrospect, it was a bit of a funeral march. We just saw it as just a gesture of defiance. I can remember the songs, the usual left-wing songs, you know, German songs, Russian songs, then some songs about the German Revolution of 1918, some politically adjusted folk songs. Germans are great singers, as you know. I was there in the middle. It was enormous. I can't even remember anybody making any speeches. I can remember this huge grey mass of people with red flags going through the city in the evening, watched by police and others.
Eric Hobsbawm must have been one of the youngest to take part in the demonstration. He was only able to because of an aunt who had other preoccupations.
If it had been my normal uncle and aunt who looked after us normally, who had by that time left, they wouldn't have allowed it. But my aunt Mimi didn't really pay all that much attention to what we were doing because she was trying hard to make ends meet. And that's how I just went. I was then, of course, part of an organisation of socialist secondary students.
But that was a communist front organisation?
Indeed it was, yes.
What made you a communist at the age of 14 or 15?
The sense that there was no present and no future unless there was an absolute fundamental change. You must realise that in Germany, in Central Europe, certainly Berlin, 31 to 33 was the bottom of the depression. Moreover, it was clearly the end of a regime which couldn't last. There was no future. My schoolfellows, who, they weren't Nazis, they were German national mostly, imperial-minded, naturally believed the future would be a revival, a national revival. Well, I couldn't. I wasn't a German. I was a Jew. I was an Englishman. But this kind of nationalism didn't work. Social democracy and liberalism clearly didn't work because you could see these parties collapsing in front of you. And so a revolution seemed a logical thing to be. I wasn't the only one. I mean, it was a time when people did turn to the left very, very sharply. I was perhaps a little young to do so, but you could not be political.
And the young Eric could not but be aware of the growing sense of menace, the thuggery, the victimisation, the intolerance.
It was controlled violence. There were street fights between militant Nazis, stormtroopers, and organised armed communists and others. It wasn't that you could see them every time you went on the street, but we were aware that this was happening. And we were certainly aware of the brutality of the stormtroopers. They went around bragging about it.
Did you ever see Hitler?
No. Heard him on the radio. I think the family would certainly try and make a point of listening to him, because, after all, you don't hear Satan talking every day. And this was it, you see. We knew that what was going to happen was not merely changing my life, but changing European history. Possibly, you may say, changing world history. It's very hard, if you go through a long life, to know whether at any particular moment you say to yourself, I am now living at a point which people will remember forever. And those months in Berlin were such a moment.
5 days after that communist march through Berlin, Adolf Hitler became Germany's chancellor. The Nazi grip on power was secure.
You can't say it was the end. I mean, I was an organised and this socialist schoolboy thing. They were expecting to be made illegal, and as I was English, I was involved.
This was after Hitler had become chancellor?
Yes, oh yes. I mean, we were engaged in actual anti-Hitler activity for those 2 or 3 months until my own family then left and went to England. But we knew by that time that we had lost. A lot of people, I think, said, he can't last, it's too crazy. I think we and my friends believed he could last and would last.
Hitler lasted, of course, for more than 12 years, until Germany's defeat in the Second World War. By then, millions were dead and Europe was devastated. Looking back over the decades, Eric Hobsbawm takes solace in his teenage political activism.
To some extent, there was this element of playing cowboys and Indians. At the same time, we did know that there was genuine risk, a real risk. We knew that we were actually doing something dangerous. Dangerous not only to ourselves, but to our families. It's nice to think that one actually did do something, however little. Insofar as we were genuinely scared, I think probably there's something to be proud of.
In April 1933, Eric Hobsbawm and his family left Berlin for London. He's since become one of the world's most renowned and widely read historians. He remained a communist for almost all his adult life. He's now in his mid-90s, still reading, still writing, and living in North London.
Andrew Whitehead. And if you'd like to hear more of our history programmes, go to bbcworldservice.com/witness.